Welcome back to the Tuesday train. Another 2MK production. Once again, today we will be fighting in Guilty Gear Xrd Rev 2. This is a US East Coast lobby. Loser stays on. Feel free to join us. Today will be a little quieter, but we are somewhat expecting some new and interesting characters to show up a little later. Until then, of course, enjoy Answers Lockdown and Jams Rushdown.
久しぶりです。スタンダムパワースパイダーアンサーです。カウンター、そうそう、そのアンサーです。カウンター、付き合う、ストップ、これだ、これだ、エンバースロスト、本気を見せましょう。見えてますよ。できる。
その予約作る屋敷でよろしい。
そこカウンター、これなら、スタッチ、これなら、これだ、シュ
ッ、あるいは、シュッ、そのようなことです
。このスピードならできる。テラカウンター、なんて威力だ。
ご返信には及びません。
これが伝え聞く忍びの技か。まさに虚実混交、合間合間に営業まで挟んでくるとは。
Generally, the team does not take Guilty Gear as seriously in terms of preparation as we do for Street Fighter, but it is among the things that we often enter at tournaments if it's available. Meaning that most of the time, the flow in this lounge is at least partially drivenby the intention to specifically get good at the game, enough to have some fun in casuals at least, or put up a challenge while in pools. As a result, you will probably see a bit more effort made to understand certain things than you'd see otherwise. Expect a lot of high level awareness play or combos, as we still don't generally work on those. Guilty Gear gets played during this lounge, so if you're feeling as if you want to get into the game, you can join up and simply let us know in the chat what you consider your own skill level to be.
気を入れたんよ、新天地やよ。
But as people who have gone to such tournaments, we can in fact tell you that the level of play we have is... Unless you're fighting someone who you don't know how to defend against at all, so far it's proven to be just about enough to not do terribly. I.e. you could still have some fun, it's not completely a wash. Except me fighting Chip that one time. Recently.
これが伝え聞く忍びの技か。まさに虚実混交、合間合間に営業まで挟んでくるとは。
I do, however, continue to be the opposite of most jam in that I normally am not trying to go in. I'm content to stay over here. And I will continue to do that until the team starts blocking it that way. I'm charging Ryujin because it's the highest chance that I will have an encounter with Answer in the air, necessitating the use of the move to get some damage on him that he might not have otherwise taken. It's not so useful against him on the ground, but still kind of worth it. Generally, it can be hard once you've charged that for Answer to make sure he gets away from Jam and therefore actually gets his lockdown. You are indeed free to join if you have not seen it. I wonder about it since you had to ask about the lounge thing, but I don't remember if we put that in the title anymore. You should be able to find the ID and password in the stream title. So yes, feel free to join in. And if you don't consider yourself that good, while we won't technically go easy, there are ways to shift one's fighting style to be a little less oppressive. Either way, we are definitely seeing a lot of flow relative to Answer's position. And Kai is actually keeping himself in that good space where Answer gets to keep Lockdown going, but doesn't really get to capitalize too much off his perches. This sort of thing requires a lot of watching for Kai's forward movement from Answer and using Answer's various teleports and similar to deal with that situation. But we are back to playing the technical game between Kai and Jam. We know how this goes. I'm looking for moments where Kai retreats to get my charges, and then capitalizing as much as I can on damage. Kai in turn is finding his spaces and getting all of his damage without worrying too much. That's the main idea he has to have. If you worry too much against Jam in this matchup, you'll just die. Another good reason is because Jam charges the card required to beat a fearless Kai last in the hierarchy of things she could charge. So making her have to charge that even just once can slow down the whole thing. When he gets over. Since it seems that Onrap is playing seriously this week, I guess I have to play seriously as well. Any skill levels you see demonstrated in these matches are not the ones we will normally be using in this dungeon. And the fake out. Guilty Gear is lots of fun once you understand all of the little things going on.
Thank you. つでもお相手します。
はい、勝利退場。
これが伝え聞く忍びの技か。まさに虚実混交、合間合間に営業まで挟んでくるとは。
Sadly, that does not work as well as I want it in this game. I was going for the galaxy brain of waking up with Bao Xianshuo on Answer's wake up, but Answer had the even more galaxy brain Answer.
ございません。時間がございません。少々お時間いただけます。
心を精錬することだ。
解、勝利、退場。
これが伝え聞く忍びの技か。まさに虚実混交、合間合間に営業まで挟んでくるとは。
アンサ
ー、あ、ジャムさん、
シンさんは寝れていますか。
清い方のよう、神殿試合第一開始。
おさあ、いくよ。
あ、どうも、アンサーです。あ、どうも。やめてください。本当に営業ではありませんよ。
Oh, I didn't have trash. Was your actually gotten answer a little flustered? The same thing happens overall as with Kai. You're generally trying to get the character.Into a situation where you charging up your stuff is not responded to. Once you've got this, generally, the rest is a matter of converting. Generally, this is completely about realizing when your opponent has switched from one mindset to the other. At the range that Answer fights at, he often has to commit to either defense or offense, making him one of the easier characters to see this for. a matchup that Unravit knows well, but being able to play it well is not the same as just knowing it well. Generally, the team has had a bit of experience blocking Leo's mix-ups to the main point. But on the other hand, every Leo has very slightly different mix-ups, even if some are considered specifically optimal. The methodology for this is not that different regardless of what the mix-up itself is. But the high-low definitely helps. And as usual, the train is back to being itself. Mostly Jam has to be careful about where she spaces herself when trying to get in and exactly how much delay she uses, because she needs the delay to make the decision as to which method to use. Axel is not a character who will give her a lot of time to charge cards, but there are some specific spaces where it will almost always happen. That, for example, is one decent option. Because nearly every one of Axel's initial attacks, even if it hits Jam, will knock her backward in a specific way relative to her air backdash. That is a decent timing to get your charge. Judging which charge you need is a different matter. You do have to have enough health to get away with this though, as Axel will definitely make sure that you do something. However, he does have a lot of moves that are relatively slower and therefore not able to do a lot of damage to her without a Roman cancel. Meaning that if you do it at the beginning of the round when he does not yet have quite enough to do it, you may be able to get a charge, and if that charge is what you really need to win the round, because of whatever your skill level happens to be versus the Axel in question, you should be able to manage unless they make a particular very hard read. Said hard read is one that would generally make Jam's standard starting position viable, so you get to guess a little bit. Unlike games where meter carries over between rounds, you can use opening gambits in nearly every situation. Answer's strength against Leo is generally a little easier to manage, as between aerial retreats and his ability to do lockdown, Leo has a hard time managing certain things. However, Leo can use a couple of his forward moving lows to get into position while holding his charge to strike upward when Answer does certain things. Once he's found his space, this happens. Answer must therefore find even more ways to stay in the air longer and the correct timing to utilize his various teleport and counter style movements. But there's that charge. Since Answer cannot actually do his lockdown style space control from the air, it requires a lot of mental awareness to actually pull this off.
Yeah.
これが伝え聞く忍びの技か。まさに虚実混交、合間合間に営業まで挟んでくるとは。
With that bit of knowledge dropped on us by our Leo player, might be some ways out of that, but that to answer staying in the air. Used to being able to play a ground game, being faced with a character who completely denies you this option can really throw you off. This is a problem you find with characters like Colleen in Street Fighter V, and to some extent Frieza in DBFZ. But as you can see there, Answer does have a solution. It just really requires a lot of calm in order to use under pressure. Since Leo must get in ways that launch strong, long attacks, but once he's reached with that attack, you don't get to do much. The solution used by Answer and quite a few other characters is to meet that incoming attack with something evasive, something that stops it directly, or in Answer's case, teleport out of the way on impact. From Leo's side, there are, of course, some really good tricks he can use to do this. Specifically, once he's reached that point of making the opponent think about this, purposely whiffing the first strike and then cancelling can really mess up someone, as their move intended to get through in the way I mentioned is usually not one that recovers all that fast. It might not be enough for Leo to get anything out of it, but it definitely usually is not enough for him to get hurt, meaning that he's now closer and probably, because he intentionally didn't finish, has managed to get enough charge to do whatever he wants next, meaning that they generally don't have a way out of the situation other than super jump followed by some heavy movement ability. And if you had that to begin with, then you probably wouldn't have had the problem. Answer's other main option is the one employed against Kai. He does have very far-reaching forward footsie buttons that are barely capable, but still capable, of stopping a lot of the things these characters want to do. Outside of that range, the cards function as a quick normal for the same purpose. The main difficulty being, Answer is not a character where you get to keep hitting footsie buttons to make sure the opponent cannot enter your space. He must make a decision after most of them about which the next one should be. In short, our Answer player is facing the same problem she faced in Street Fighter. Learn to stay quiet in scrambles. For example, at the moment you can see a lot of preemptive card use, which aren't terribly bad, but don't really help against Kai. Becoming comfortable with that moment of not taking an action is a super important skill for this character until you can get some bigger combos down. Fortunately, his defense is quite good and he's not so easily freaked out by other people's actions. Scrambles tend to favor Answer unless he's up against his boss or, interestingly, Potemkin. Tenley Jacko does not count because Jacko is never really in neutral. Against Axel, who functionally also negates footsies, Answer has a simpler option. Once he has managed to occupy the space required, he can teleport around quite easily. But once again, the issue is learning to remain calm and not do anything in particular in the scrambles that are created, as Axel has huge advantage in any scrambles these two have. Generally, the incredibly greater range means the answer has a lot of problems dealing with just about anything Axel chooses to do there. And since he does not have a lot of cross-up style buttons, getting over Axel's head to then make certain attacks is difficult, which is why you see the ground perches are the main requirement. That is also one of Answer's better options when absolutely stressed out in the scramble. Just go for the teleport, because Axel's moves are slow enough, at least in certain grounded ones, that if you really weren't sure what else could be done, the worst that will happen is that you'll get hit the same way you would have gotten hit doing anything else. Good use of the super. But that was a hard situation to be in. Given that any read from Axel on a quick air bat dash might have clipped. But another try at staying out of Leo's way. There are, of course, times where you are coming down from the jump, where you can't get away, you can't instantly jump again. But, unfortunately, going in means you get caught in Leo's locking, and then you die. So, unfortunately, that initial decision has more or less led to this. Therefore, maybe I should have said, the first lesson is don't go in on Leo with Answer until you have some advantage. You don't have enough meter to do it. But there we have the crouching heavy, I believe, that moves Leo forward while maintaining enough charge to deal with Answer if he goes into the air in particular spaces. But then, trapped in corner, reaction is to try to get out, and to do so while attacking. But, and there we go again. So our Leo player responds literally perfectly to every scramble decision and gets the summit reward for doing so. Now that Kai's flow is a little bit more precise, it's harder for Answer to keep the same lockdown space. Let's go. You'll notice, of course, also that over time, Kai gets more and more used to that aerial attack from Answer in that particular way, and is generally waiting more and more for it. When you've reached the point of basically giving your opponent anti-air practice, you probably need to rethink your strategy a little bit, unless you've been landing everyone into a big combo. This is part of the reason why it's so useful to learn big jump-in combos in games. To minimize the amount of time your opponent has to get used to your anti-air timings and spacings. Doesn't matter if they can anti-air you occasionally, if they die first. In this slower paced match, Answer gets to put down both sets of perches, increasing his options and making sure that he does not have to deal with Kai just doing as he likes. Once the high perches go down, adding the lower ones means it's a little bit easier to make mix-ups out of the whole thing. This shouldn't be too laggy. I believe these two players are actually closer together than most of us here. Axel has a little more trouble dealing with Leo, but as we've discussed before, it's mostly a matter of frustrating Leo enough that he keeps on getting hit by the invincible wake up. Going into the air can help. But since it's so hard to actually do good damage that way, Axel has to be really confident in his play in order to make this a good plan. That is his other good option. Both Rush Olsen and that forward Sparrow Strike mean that it's difficult for Leo to be absolutely certain that any good thing is happening when he gets to a particular range. That is Axel's main problem once he goes into the air. He does not have any really good straight down attacks to resolve the situation. It's often therefore good for him to not super jump and just hop once and then jump straight up again to resolve his problems rather than going for any attack at all. The difficulty being that generally one executionally ends up super jumping while playing defense against Leo. And it requires a lot of effort to make sure you didn't. Literally hard countered. This match we know well, but we've discussed before that Kai plays this different ways. Grinders are helpful against repositioning Axel, But against Axels, who just measure the space constantly without moving, it tends to be less useful than, interestingly, Greed Sever. While Greed Sever has definitely become punishable for most characters, perfectly spaced, Axel is not necessarily one of those characters. The execution required for it is quite high, and if Axel had any other intentions of using other moves to tie out, chances are it's not going to help. Once he's in the corner though, since there is no respacing to be done, it plays out like regular Axel versus Kai. This is a multi-layer though, as we did initially point out that Axel has to advance a bit against most characters to prevent them from getting to full screen and then approaching him from there, where green blocking and other techniques are slightly better for getting in on him. That forward movement then opens him up to more Greed Sever stuff. So, you have to remember quite a little bit about this matchup, depending on which style of player you are and which style of player the Axel in question is. From Axel's perspective, there's not much to do other than increase awareness and execution and throw in some Rashosen for good measure just to freak out your opponent. As the player gets more and more focused on every other little piece of the matchup required, it's a little bit easier to land said Rashosen. But you do have to convince them that something needs to be done. But we're back to Ino for a bit. This match we know well enough. But our Axel has learned more tricks than you'd expect to deal with this flow. Mostly because their style of play means they're not actually going to try to get around the zoning. But rather rely on their own measurement and their understanding of the Ino player's mentality to get through. Generally worrying less about the note means that one can spend more time paying close attention to positions on screen and just block out a lot of them. learning when to read your opponent's mindset, not necessarily their mind, and taking it to mean something specific, is required for a lot of this game because of the myriad tactics required to beat any given character. On the other hand, sometimes just a pure stubbornness is enough to get you through. Which is, in a way, reading your own mindset. If you realize you've gotten too stressed out about something, but you're not sure that your opponent is really thinking, outthinking you, then you should probably just be stubborn. Doing that again. What was it last week? Did we ever check? That's why they didn't trade their maintenance back to Tuesdays. Maybe. I'll give a bit of it now, and you'll hear it again if we happen to continue with the stream, but if this is not able to get back up, obviously this will be the end of our Tuesday train for today, and obviously you can check back next week for the next Tuesday train, presuming that this does not continue every Tuesday. This time we'll probably actually look into why it is, but tomorrow you can join us for Street Fighter V Sandbag Casual segment at the same time. And on Thursday, our Dragon Ball FighterZ Beginner Lobby Tame House. On Friday, we'll be having our Dead or Alive Last Round Lounge, as there is no content to be done this week for Dragon Ball FighterZ bot. And next week, Monday, we will be back to Street Fighter V Mishmashing Lounge. Are we back? Let's find out. Indeed we are. So presumably that was just a minor hiccup, or we'll find out in a moment if we're unable to get back in it. No, we appear to be back on. So the Tuesday train was not necessarily derailed. Our new ID is QYP1. We'll be attempting to change this in the stream title fairly soon. There might be a little delay. Well, we've got that fixed, so we are back into the action. Nothing much to say on this match. If you've been watching our streams at all, you know that we've covered it from nearly every possible angle. Let's just appreciate some Kai theme. Things are a little flickery around, so we will have some missing parts. But we should settle back in a little bit.
Yeah! 色気の武器に頼りすぎね。そんなのいつまでも続かないよ。また
While Jam is definitely not a character with whom you want to play patiently most of the time, when going up against characters with strong space control and footsies of their own, especially if they can outrun you in the retreat, you have to pick your battles, i.e. go in when you are absolutely confident it will work because you have managed to land a specific hit.In the interest of fairness, not every one of Jam's knockdowns actually gives you good pressure.
が売りなのね。でもちょっと長すぎるな。何事も程度が重要なの。
勝利ですね。勝利。進展試合第2戦例を持って。さあ、おいしさ。ここだ。
Oof, the power of that move. Just remember, kids, if you're willing to run up DP, you might as well greet Sever 2. Part of the reason why so many people have actually started writing notes and matchup notes is because when you play a game where people can have meaningfully different styles, it becomes super important to make sure that you have all of your ducks in a row for facing one style or the other. As often, what really happened is a player saw what your character could do and chose one of two ways to approach it. If you only counter way number one, there's a chance that way number two is going to wreck you. What is the aforementioned other method Jam can use? Just neutral jump. Ooh, a hard counter, literally. My opponent is very good at reading my rhythm, meaning that I have to spend a lot of time recovering in very specific ways. It's harder to read a player's rhythm when they're already being hit, as you can't immediately tell what their intention is, given the fact that you don't know when they recognized that they were hit. This is a strange thing that creates scrambles where they don't necessarily need to exist. When both players are crouching in neutral just waiting for the other to make a move, you can learn how long it takes before the person gets antsy, because this is a choice they've made. But sometimes when you hit a player with a move, you can't tell how long they had to recognize that they were hit, and this can change their response. Meaning that sometimes what seems random is completely predictable and based on their particular mindset in a specific space. But the timing shifts and has nothing to do with you at all. Ooh, max range on that. And a dead angle. But enough super on Axel's side barely to push back. One main reason to keep on placing Kick House is because Axel cannot spend as much time controlling Jacko's air approaches while still making sure as to get rid of the grounded minions. Once she's actually close though and intends to stay there or expects to be close soon, the punch house tends to be a bit better. Meaning that it is normally the one that goes down in the lull between attack strings that happens if Axel manages to get away from her but does not necessarily hit her. It's a really easy thing to remember as a whole. But here we have expecting to be close, expecting to be able to stay close-ish, making the punch house better. And a standing kick to close it out. Oh, that perfect daring forward jump from Axel. For Axel, that is actually a fairly strong option in this matchup. When just staying there with Kai, as he has both good pushback to control the space. And a lot of good reasons why Kai's buttons can't really be used on reaction to it in the same way you'd expect. He will sometimes though have to green block in the air to avoid a lot of Kai's specials. Meaning that this is not a thing you can do in certain situations, and it telegraphs itself fairly hard sometimes. And of course, it goes back to the same problem as before, where one must deal with the air grinder as part of this interaction. So yet another space where something that ceased to be all that meaningful or a good idea because of a difference in style comes back into the fore when a slight adaptation is made. You can find this sort of matchup tactic shuffling in a lot of games, as characters only have a certain amount of options in the first place. It's quite likely that at some point, high level play will be a matter of shuffling around options and understanding which ones your opponent is likely to feel comfortable with. Too high. Characters with evasive hitboxes specialize in making you think it's time to respond, and they often have pressure in order to make you feel you have to. As your reactions improve, this shifts, probably quite heavily, and the pressuring player must get better and better at forcing you to feel that way. Normally, though, the main result is that they will simply pressure more to try to get you into the mindset where you feel pressure is coming and think, I can beat that pressure if I go for this. Now that was a close one, but with perfect spacing on Jack O's kick, we were able to see the space taken up in the same way as usual based on the position of the houses. And that paying off in the long term. Ooh, a bold choice putting down S House. But it could have been all one bait actually. That is one of the most advanced concepts in real estate management. place two houses that you know you specifically don't mind if they get destroyed in order to get the third one. But quick awareness means that Jaco is not able to get over to date. That sequence there explains, at least to some extent, why Kai is not a character who can really go for his uppercut to deal with everything Jaco is doing as a standard answer. There are some times where he can just go for wave aggressive, but the recovery of this almost always involves him getting dealt with in some way due to the interaction between that move and Jaco's minions. You've just seen it there. If Jaco puts down a house and immediately jumps, Kai using Vapor Thrust will almost always have the same timing as the minion emerging, which is completely different than the normal situation in which Jaco gets hit and therefore has no minions. This trick requires that you have a fairly heavy amount of trust in your ability to fake out your opponent as Jaco, but if you can get it, it's really frustrating. It works on nearly every character, and in certain situations, Jaco can even manage to defend herself in the air, meaning that the opponent never even gets to try this. At extremely high levels of play, Jaco players can measure the distance with one set of eyes and watch the animation required for the house to put out a minion, or just time it manually, and make their approach based entirely on that, knowing that if they are hit, the hit will result in them not losing the minion because the minion is just about to emerge, rather than the other way around. This is generally not so safe to do as there's nothing to cover you, but if you think your opponent is stressed out, you may be able to get something out of it. there's that level sort of thing that makes people talk about her being a MOBA character. As mentioned many times before, Jam's main flow, at least when I'm playing her, is actually to try to move around them. And that is why S House is so effective, because it limits her move around options. I had no faith whatsoever in that though. Another strong tactic which is seldom used is in the situation you just saw where Jacko is pushing the opponent back into houses, but she knows that as soon as they get there, they will destroy them. That is probably the moment in this game completely intended for the use of her blow everything up technique. Is the most controlled situation available to her for this, as she knows she's going to be pushing the opponent into that range shortly. And she knows that as soon as she does, most likely the houses are going to be destroyed. From the other side, of course, you see here, her control is overall improved. Kai in turn is learning when exactly the rhythm of Jackal's retreats come in, and therefore when to go for certain things. Note that, despite the explosion going off, she was able to call back and therefore get Max Power Kick House, and at this point it's just a matter of attrition and not really being able to do anything at all from Kai's side. As you get more and more used to controlling this character, those four abilities she has start to make more and more sense, as they all fill different spaces in the match, even if they're only used once or twice. This is because usually the situations they are affecting are not situations that come up so often. At least if you're playing correctly, they don't. This, for example, is a position where often it is best to just put up the defense, spear, ball, whatever you want to call it, which prevents Kai from being able to damage anything with his projectiles, allowing her to build up minions from behind her to fit her needs. From this side, as you've seen, speeding up the house, knowing that it will not be destroyed easily, even if it does not pay off directly, tends to give Jao a lot of space. And in a long match like this, you can see that her abilities have actually already recharged for the most part. Perfect meter gain into perfect use of meters. Well, you know what they say, for whom the bell tolls, it tolls for thee.
Let's go. 親善試合第2全米を持て
ここじゃあここあじわここあじわここあいくよあじわこここれだけかあじわここじゃあ当たらないよあじわ
カウンター
worked primarily because when going all out, Jam builds up a lot of risk meter. Sometimes, depending on how much health she has, you use her speed to stay on your opponent not because you intend or expect to even get out of it without taking damage, but because you know they can't do enough damage to you to win the round off it. The risk meter buildup changes her from a character who needs to use multiple mix-ups to win, to one who can squeeze it out with just one.
精錬することだ。
海、勝利、隊長。
戦闘スタイルの異なる相手から学ぶことは実に多い。私の所作もあなたの糧になれば幸いです。
前にさ、人間は外見や所作で大体中身がわかる的な本が流行ったわけよ。興味もあったし欲しかったんだけど、なんかもういらなくな
った。はい、
ジャック王様、シンさんは寝れていますか？
神殿試合第一開始。
これなら、
そこここだ。ゲラ
見えてますよ。
そこゲラ、そこそこ
観察だな。
見えてますよ。
そこだ。
In this situation, Kai must be careful not to give up too much space. Since if Jackal recognizes that she can push Kai to the corner without necessarily needing to put down houses right away, she will delay their placement until she is closer to that corner, putting more pressure on it. Similarly, with nowhere to go relative to the Elysian driver attack, it may be more difficult for him to spend his spacing to get an advantage. This is even more compounded by the fact that if she actually has her various abilities available, it's very difficult for Kai to actually prevent her from doing these things. So he has to be careful about how much he gives up in order to lure her into making mistakes. Jackal does not specifically fear being cornered, as Kai is not a strong corner pressure character, and she's reasonably good at escaping. But similarly, reading when Kai has decided to switch to aggression as a result of this is something Jackal has to pick up as a player. Well, Jackal's player must pick up. In order to not get caught in the trap of thinking too binarily about it. In the case of Axel, the situation is actually the opposite. Jackal generally wants to get herself a little closer to the corner or definitely put them down in mid-neutral so that she doesn't have to worry about trying to reposition relative to his spacing. While she cannot necessarily lose quickly based on being cornered, various interactions between the two characters mean that she wants to stay in the middle of the screen as long as possible. As you can see, she tends to not have a lot of meter to work with, in contrast to at least part of the Kai matchup. And Axel can push her around a lot more than Kai can. She has to therefore spend a lot of time making sure she is not going to get cornered during her own attacks. Axel's ability to use Rashosen and pull her closer in other ways means that one of her best options is to simply get out as soon as she pushes him too near the corner. After all, he's not a character where you care too much if he escapes, as long as he isn't hurting you in the process. It is in fact easier for her to defend herself while this is going on. By moving at least a little bit away. You see there, part of the main reason why this is so. Even though Jackal can escape from the corner, an Axel who is waiting for this can damage her quite heavily for doing it, giving him an advantage that pays out over time. In that situation where she gets the knockdown, the situation's a bit better overall. But if you thought you were going to get the knockdown, then it really didn't matter. Unlike Kai, it is also relatively difficult for her to land Elysian Driver in standard situations, as Axel does get to keep attacking for quite a while. As our players work more and more on their awareness, you're likely to see new strategies popping up. But they won't necessarily be directly matchup things, more so character mastery. This is an important stage for most players in all games, getting better at playing the character itself in tiny ways that make a lot of difference when facing particular opponent types.
戦においてはまず相手の背後を見ることです。態度があれば知能。
In this case, Jackal put her best foot forward, but it was not quite enough. And you should be thankful I was about to make a worse joke, but I held back.
ちょっと前にさ、人間は外見や所作で大体中身がわかる的な本が流行ったわけや。興味があってしっこしかったんだけど。
Thank you. よどんでいる。
はい、勝利。
神殿試合で第二切磋せよ。
どうも見
てんね。
捕らえた。
アー
マ
ーさん、
アーマーさん、
下だ。
戦においては
some very clean spacing there. But it does seem as if the execution requirements are causing the mental stat to favor Axel in this match.
Yeah.
You saw a hesitation on the Elysian driver the first time. But looks like Jacko decided to go all in on it that time, and it paid off. And so the train rolls on. We do have a small shift in lag, but it seems to have stabilized again. For some reason, I've decided to call that setup barbecue flavor.
Thank you. 定します。
はい、勝利対象。
戦闘スタイルの異なる相手から学ぶことは実に多い。私の所作もあなたの糧になれば幸いです。
Patience pairs off there primarily because Jacko is not a character that has to worry too much about the risk build-up from Axel. Most of her stronger strategies do not involve caring about this setup, and with high enough levels of anything, she can just set up regardless to start over. And a perfect application of corner control means that now Axel must deal with powered up kick minions. At this point, it looks like she gave up her life lead, so this will probably go to Axel in the end. Axel's slow and careful approach, continuing to poke from long range, seems to be stressing Jao's general flow. And while she does have the tools to defeat this sort of thing, the execution is a bit much sometimes. Since she lacks a good forward low with punish in most situations, it's difficult to really fluster him for doing that particular method of striking. However, one can adapt based on the fact that once Axel is in this mode, both Blitz and Roman cancels become more effective. that in the end, this is the match that lasted right to basically the end of our stream. As mentioned before, we will be having Standby Casuals in Street Fighter V tomorrow, and on Thursday, our beginner Kame House Lobby for Dragon Ball FighterZ. On Friday, Dead or Alive, last round, another lounge. And next Monday, our mishmashing battle lounge for Street Fighter V. But in this case, the Tuesday train has reached its destination station, and we are getting off here. This has been Rillian 14-2MK. Good luck with your training, and good night, everyone.